I'd like to welcome you to the small presentation of PEU11 at the campus party. PEU11 is a small startup we started 4 months ago, and I will show you what we are currently doing. I will give you a short presentation about the solution and actually the technical challenges that we had to survive in the last couple of months. So I will talk you through this thing. I will give you a short presentation, what we're actually doing, what was architectural, the part that we had to do, what's the non-trivial part if you do an app development that actually has to do something with sensors or with attached devices. I will talk about scalability and security, especially in the payment space, something that is non-trivial, as some of you maybe already have some experience with. If you have an e-commerce shop, maybe you know a few things about security that you have to take care of. And the last part, maybe the most interesting part for some of you, would be how you integrate hardware with an application that is in the mobile space. So what's the product? Actually, if you want to accept card payments today, you have to have a cumbersome old terminal. And what we are currently doing is we want to enable small and medium-sized enterprises to actually allow card payments everywhere and at any time and with no cost whatsoever. So no cumbersome terminal that you actually need. And why are we doing this? Because actually payment space is something like the oldest space that you have, and it is completely awkward. Yeah, you have terminals where a small coffee shop actually needs to buy a huge chunk of hardware. It needs to have something like a fixed line. It needs to build something like it has to purchase something on lease. And this whole thing smells like the mobile business that you had something like 20 years ago. When you wanted to have something like a mobile phone, you actually had to go on a contract. Same thing is currently with the terminals. If you want to have a terminal, you have to go on a contract, and these contracts usually run something like 48 to 60 months. Nobody actually wants that, but everybody currently wants to pay with credit cards. Take a look at the US, where you have a huge card presentation. Take a look into your wallets and you will see at least two or three cards. In Germany especially, you will see a lot of debit cards. In other countries like the UK, you will see at least everybody having minimum two credit cards. Yeah, so the solution that we came up with is actually something, it's a small attachment that you have on your iPhone that you connect to our application. Then you enter the amount, you enter your description, and you swipe your card, and then you present this thing to the end consumer that actually can sign with his finger. That's the magical moment that you actually have with most of the consumers when they the first time can feel something like, my finger actually does something on the smartphone screen. This concept is by no means our own innovation. Maybe a few of you know Square from the US. So of course we are confronted sometimes with this nice little argument that we're just cloning Square, but I will tell you that we're not doing that, and there are a few reasons why we're not doing that, and one of the reasons is that we are actually not in the US and that we are currently addressing the rest of the world. So I will give you a small overview about the MPOS space, so the mobile point of sale space currently. If you take a look at the most dominant players that we currently have, we have on the left-hand side, you have the consumer penetration, so who actually does what when he wants to pay. And you have the merchant penetration on the other end, so where actually can you pay with these kind of solutions. So you have a lot of innovative companies that try to do something like QR code payment. Now, the length of the boxes actually tells you something about the market share and about the penetration within the markets. So you see that even if you come up with something like QR code payment, there's actually very small base of installed payment acceptance points where you can actually pay with QR codes. And the same goes with, let's say, mobile wallet solutions like even large players and PayPal and Google are currently addressing. So that's why we opted, for example, to go to something that actually doesn't change consumer behavior. Because the one thing that we actually have everybody in his wallet is a credit or a debit card. So the one thing that we want to address is the merchant penetration so that we create a lot more of touch spaces and acceptance points within Europe, within the rest of the world, USA excluded, so that you can pay the normal thing like you do today. Yeah, so you give the merchant your card, he swipes it through, you sign, same user experience as you have done before. No change there. What means global? I mean, if you take a look at something like the application stores that you have today, it's uploading one thing and then just clicking the boxes that you actually want to go into these countries. This is true for a normal mobile application. In our particular space, it's not that easy because actually it's a financial transaction that you need to have. And coming from the card industry, maybe you will know that if you want to have a credit card acceptance agreement for your e-commerce shop, you will have this for one country. So if you want to do this thing globally, you actually need to have credit card acceptance agreements all over the place. So this means, for example, for a small e-commerce shop, going into the payment space is very cumbersome. Now take this thing one notch further down, take a look at the MPOS payment, where we want to address not only the small and medium-sized enterprises in Germany or in Europe, but we want to address them also in Singapore or in Hong Kong. And this, of course, means that we need to build an application that actually works globally, but with global partners, financial transactions behind this, and adhering to the local regulations. So this, of course, makes app development in our particular part a little bit more tricky than the usual part. So this, of course, then comes into what does it mean for software development, what does it mean for the IT people, actually. We have a few things that are systemic requirements. So, of course, we have a payment application. This means that we have to be available 24/7, 365. If an e-commerce shop is down for 1 hour, actually nobody cares. Because it's in the middle of the night, nobody wants to do a purchase. If we are not up and running, and we are addressing something like the whole world, meaning we don't have something like one time zone that we're not in, this means that we have to be there all of the time. And we, of course, have to be reliable there. So it's not something like, oh, your payment doesn't work, because that's not the user experience that you want to have with the end consumer, right? The merchant will only accept your payment solution if it actually, every time that you swipe, you actually make a payment. And of course, take a look at the pickup. If you would see the PayPal transactions, in the last 10 years. It's the normal hockey stick that every startup currently is searching for. But this means, of course, if you are up 24/7, 365, that you better get your shit together before, so you have a scalable solution when you start rolling out, and because you don't have something like huge windows of opportunity to change your system and make it scalable afterwards. Okay? So the next thing is, or the next box actually is a little bit more, let's say, more from the product side. Yeah, you have to deliver something reliable. You have to deliver all of the time. And this means that, of course, if regulations change in Southeast Asia, you have to change these things within an instant. But at the same time, keeping the European version up and running and also the European backends up and running. Yeah. So this is something that actually is easy to write on a box, and it's extremely difficult to implement in IT development. Yeah. Everybody of you usually, I guess, is using a Scrumish version of or Scrumish development cycles, where you have all these things like we want to be agile. Try to be agile and at the same time be reliable and available. That's the triangle that we actually had to maneuver in. Yeah. Next up, of course, is if you want to do something like this, you want to grow. So payment for us is, of course, only the beginning. What you are currently seeing in the application, or what you will be seeing in the application, is only the payment terminal. That's the beginning of the whole story. Yeah? But this, of course, means that you will start to build a product. And the product first is get rid of the terminals, get rid of the payments, and then make all of the small, medium-sized enterprise merchants happy. Because the business model that we have is pay-as-you-go. This is not something like you have to pay royalty fees every now and then. So if they don't do transactions because they're not happy with the solution, we're not earning any money. Now, what does it mean to actually do something like app development in our particular space? Most of you are confronted, or most of the developers that do application development are confronted with the same problems that we have. Our actual complexity comes from not only having the app development, because that's something that everybody has, but having the devices that we have to integrate. To give you a funny example, yeah, we have something like iOS with huge penetration, you have most of the people already on iOS 5.x, whatever, running. Yeah? Now take a look at the Android platform. Everybody knows that the Android platform is fragmented. That's one thing. But actually, the Android platform not only is fragmented, but you actually have differences in how you can access different hardware layers or layers within the OS system itself. This, for example, means for us that even though we would code for something like Gingerbread and we would have something like the super excited Gingerbread developer running up and down the street, yeah, you will hit certain devices that actually are not performing correctly because the audio connection within the manufacturer is not coded as it should be, or not behaving as it was designed to happen. So this complexity actually leads for us to something like we have to integrate each and every single device. Now take a look, for example, at what you have in Android, where you have trillions of devices and every single day a new device is coming out. To give you the best example that we had a Samsung S2 late 2010 model, where we had a nice extraction of the audio wave that looked like a nice sinus curve. We had the same Samsung S2, early 2011 model, same thing, same OS version, and the waveform actually looked like this. So because everybody is trying to shave off their 10 cents out of the devices to increase their margin in the manufacturing places, we actually have to deal not only with different devices, different OS versions, but also different components within the applications, within the manufacturers. This is the complexity that actually makes this thing a little bit slower and a little bit more complex, and we have to actually find in IT the solutions to work against these kind of environment. So why do we need to scale? You've seen that we want to have something like the global reach going into South America, going into Southeast Asia, going into Europe. This of course means that we have to be up and running, but this also means that maybe you have the holiday rush in, or Chinese holidays in China or in Hong Kong, so everybody is buying like crazy, and this means that you always have to prepare for peaks. And it's not something like you have an even distribution like you would have with a normal application or with a normal IT system, where you have the normal midday break and then afterwards at 6 p.m. it goes up again. So we have extreme peaks when something happens. It could be an event, it could be something like this, when somebody is selling and using the solution like this, like ours in the campus party environment, then you would see peaks at midday, but extremely peaks. Yeah? So this of course means that we have to scale on each and every tier of the application. How do we do that? Just browse quickly through these things, give you a short update, or just a few a few key points how we actually managed to do that. We start with a data tier. That actually is the database where we store everything. Yeah. So we have functional segmentation that is actually trying to split the whole application into different functions. So we have, of course, the merchant, we have transactions, we have settlements, we have all this kind of thing, and we have fraud, and we have risk systems, and so on and so forth. But this means that the database, if you would structure this like a normal, like your normal database, this would be one database. Yeah. So of course not, we are structuring this in different functions. Yeah, and then together with the application tier, that's the vertical code partitioning, from our end, everything is a silo. So if you're talking about a merchant, the merchant has its own application, has its own database. This, of course, then leads to other things like, okay, what's with, you have all merchants and 90% of the merchants start with a letter M. Yeah. So then you have something like your table is segmented, you have way too many things in the middle, you have not so many things in the A to Z thing, you don't have not so many things in the M and N section. So you start doing horizontal splits. This usually, if you take a look at the NoSQL databases, it's done with sharding quite right away. Yeah. So that's something that we have to do. Just from the business model, from day one, to ensure scalability. The next thing on the database layer is that we actually have logical DB hosts. Why? Because we have something like a transaction database, and this transaction database grows like crazy. So this means that in the beginning we will have something like one database, and then if we are up and running and you see more and more transactions coming in, you will have merchants growing, but at the same time the transactions are growing exponentially. This of course means that from one point to the other you have to switch databases without any downtimes, because 24/7, 365. Yeah, so this means that you abstract even the databases before an ERM. Application tier, I already mentioned vertical code partitioning, meaning creating silos for different functions, so that you can actually then segment the functions within the silos, and in the second tier you make something like a platform decoupling. Platform decoupling is quite a technical term, means something like you have the data layer in between, you have the application layer and the business layer, and you put everywhere you have something like breakpoints where you can actually switch from just having one particular server or one particular function running into something like a multi-staged cluster approach. Now, the last thing that we actually, of course, need to scale as well to create and maintain something like an application like this, and especially the backends of the application, you have to make sure that your operations are also up and running. This means that we have to be able to deploy code at any time and at any hour, and also within very small steps. So what we are currently trying to achieve is something, and if you are an app developer, you know that you can't do something like seamless code deployment all of the time, because Apple is screwing you, Android is screwing you, because they tell you something like, oh, we have to go through the review, you have to wait 1 or 2 weeks. So completely random. This of course means that we have to make sure that the application is able to run with multiple backends and multiple versions, and we are able to deploy the backends every second if we want to have. So micro deployments. So we're doing payment, and payment means money, and money means that of course everybody is concerned about the security and about the compliance of the solution. So we have three layers that we actually have to put security in. One is the hardware layer, the second is the application layer, and then of course we have the backends with the transaction machine and all the risk and fraud management parts. So there are actually a few security standards that maybe some of you know, I guess most of you never heard of, and to be honest, it's better if you don't go there. Yeah. So hardware is something that is extremely difficult and is very highly regulated, because nobody actually wants to have card data stolen, nobody wants to erase card data, nobody wants his EMV chip manipulated, so you have to be very strict on the compliance on this part. Yeah. So the encryption standards that we are working on the hardware part is a 2048 AES standard, and of course the triple desk duck put that is not a well-known standard in the web world, but is actually the absolute must standard on the terminal world. That's a triple desk encryption, so a very weak encryption, but duck put actually means derived unique key per transaction. This means that every single transaction that you are doing is working with another key. So even if you compromise one key, you will never see the whole sequence, you will never see anything else. It's always changing, so you don't have that much of a chance as a hacker to attack these kind of encryption standards. Yeah? Even though triple desk is weak, you can hack this on an iPhone. Yeah? So it's no part. In the moment that you start working with EMV cards, that's the funny little chip cards that you have in your wallet, you will have to adhere to EMV certification. This is something like you don't destroy the chip, you read the real data out of the chip, and you don't compromise the integrity of the chip. Then depending on the hardware that you're using, you will also have to adhere to something like PCI, PTS, and PCI SRED. PCI is the Payment Council Institution that maybe some of you already know. That's the people that actually want you to make something like an SSL connection when you handle printed cards on your e-commerce shop or in the application. And they actually have a huge set of standards that you need to comply with if you're doing hardware. SRED, for example, is secure read and encrypt data. This means that in the second that you touch the credit card data, you already encrypt the data so that you never have plain text data within them. Yeah. Same thing on the application. You have to have a compliant secure communication layer. That's the part that everybody knows from e-commerce shops. Only the good ciphers from SSL, not the old RC4 crap that everybody can put something in the middle and crack with an old phone. Yeah? And you, of course, need to make sure that your developers know what they're dealing with. So that actually they adhere to something like security standards, that you make code reviews and make sure that everything that touches payment data is, of course, reviewed at least two or three times. Again, taking this into consideration with the fast path and the fast turnover that you need usually in a startup environment makes it a little bit cumbersome to make this thing happen both at once. But actually, we need to do this. Same thing, of course, then in the backends. We encrypt in the first point, and then the whole encrypted data flows into the backends. Well, we actually need to decrypt the whole data. If you do something like AES or triple desk duck put, you can do this in software, or actually you can buy specialized hardware that actually then runs into a secure environment and decrypts the whole data and makes the whole key management for you and everything that you need to do. Yeah? So now the funniest part. The funniest part that we had to deal with is actually the hardware integration. Hardware integration for us was three things that we need to make sure. The first thing is the connectivity. Even though this dongle that you're seeing on the picture looks completely simple, you have, as I described before, you have the different audio chips, you have the different OSs, the different handling of audio. And we are talking about, we have something like three generation of devices already lined up, so we're not talking only audio, we have also some other forms of communication. So we actually need to make sure that the integration of the device is, first of all, up and running in each and every single device. Second of all, it is working with all of the OSs. And third of all, you won't believe people come with funny things like, oh, I don't have this thing plugged in completely, or I'm screwing with this thing around, or I sit my dog sat on this thing and it's a little bit awkward, and all these kind of things. So you actually need to create something that addresses the integration. Second of all, due to the different parts that we have in the audio chips, you have redundant algorithms that actually interpret the data in two, three, four different ways. The funniest thing that we had, for example, was that for us it was logical that we are swiping the card from left to right. Now guess what? We showed this thing the first time to an Asian person and it was swiping it the other way around. So of course we had to then build the algorithm that actually interprets the thing from two sides, so it's for lefties and for righties. Yeah? So it works on both ends now. Then it has to be convenient, because actually your small and medium enterprise merchants are not the sharpest tool in the box. Yeah, so they are the coffee owner, the repairman that goes to your home. So the usual plumber is not the most eloquent user for an IT system. Yeah, so this thing actually has to be completely foolproof, and you have to have fallbacks if something doesn't work. Last but not least, in this sector, the most interesting part, of course, is not compromising security while you integrate hardware. So we have devices that actually have security features within the devices. The most interesting part that I always love in these kind of devices, if you take a look at a normal terminal, yeah, if you really want to screw with the terminal, just try to open it up. Yeah? Because the funny thing is, if you try to open up a normal, decent terminal, it will kind of explode. Yeah, so you have something like funny little private keys within the terminals, and if you just slam a screwdriver in the middle and try to open this thing up, you will hear a small little zzz, yeah, and that's when the key was erased. Yeah, so that's something that, of course, you need to make sure that also your decent plumber, yeah, does not try to, oh, it doesn't work, let me try to look inside and see what's happening, I will fix it myself. Yeah, so these kinds of things, of course, then are a little bit difficult to handle. Okay, this was just a small overview of how to create a mobile payment solution in 4 months that is actually live right now in 3 countries on 2 continents, and we will be rolling this thing out within the next 6 weeks in the next 3 to 4 countries, and we need some sleep if possible in between. Okay, anyone? We make a short Q&A.
Hi. So for the device you plug into the phone, you use the audio output. Is it only because the USB ports are not standardized, or are there also other reasons?
And which card does your device accept? Which card?
We can do one more question. Is there anyone who wants to ask a question here?
Do you think you can be successful in the shadow of Google Wallet? I wasn't there.
Thank you very much. Please, everyone, an applause. Thank you.